Day the Lord has made, let us rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning and welcome to this service of worship at Westminster Presbyterian Church. There are lots of announcements in the bulletin and I want to highlight a few of them. Today, immediately following worship, youth and their parents are invited to go to Zoe's on Bearden Hill to do some planning for the upcoming year. So meet Barbara and Daniel there at 11:15. Women's Bible study, the morning edition, starts this Thursday because I have, thank goodness, a conflict to finally close on a house Thursday. Yay. Thank you. My gracious hostess is really giving thanks that I'm. So I'd like to bump the time from 10 to 10:30 with your indulgence. We'll be meeting in the fellowship hall, so meet there at 10:30, please, on Thursday morning. If you don't have a book, there are some in the office, and I'll have some with me as well. Let's see. Next week is our final week of a single worship service, but also there's some other stuff going on that's going to prevent us from using the pavilion for a little while. So we're not going to have any Sunday school classes next week, but we start up with our regular schedule on September 12th. Can you believe we're getting to September 12th? So we're back to two worship services. The 9 o'clock will be out in the pavilion again, 11 o'clock in here with the Sunday school hour in between. And that day we're going to have some fun things going on after the worship service, so mark your calendar. We've planned some really good events, and it's mostly just fellowship stuff, food, fun, and fellowship. We're calling it Barbara, what are we calling it? Reconnect, refresh, and thank you. So that'll be on the 12th. Mark your calendar. And I just want to urge you to give generously to Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. There are so many needs right now, and there's information in your bulletin about that, but also you can talk to Grady Parsons. If you have any questions, please give generously. And with that, I think we can, oh, okay.
Minute for mission.
Well, nobody told me that.
It was a surprise.
I am very pleased to introduce to you my good friend, Doris Thomas. You know about the big event that we had last summer. She is an elder at Emmanuel Presbyterian, and she and I were on either end of that to try to make that happen in a week's time, right? As she has a few words to say to us this morning.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I am probably feeling like I could go to the roof and just soar. The participation that this church family provided for Emmanuel Presbyterian Church is unprecedented. I was a little scared when I sent Barbara an email. She was on vacation. And Barbara had always said to me, if you need us, call us. Now, people say that all the time. If you need me, call me. So I prayed about it. And God said, ask. And I respected her vacation time, but I still ask. I sent her the same email I sent it to Daniel. Maybe if Barbara, I don't hear from her, maybe I'll hear from Daniel. And for a while, I didn't hear anything. And I said, Lord, does that mean that it's not going to happen? Because I was really prepared to just cancel the whole event, because we don't have the manpower that we used to have at our church. But I woke up one morning and I saw a huge yes on my phone. And she asked again to confirm the date. And she said, I'll be there. When she told me she was loading up a, what size was that truck?
It was a 15-foot U-Haul truck.
She said, I'm bringing a 15-foot U-Haul truck. And she said, we talked about the time, and I said, that's excellent. So I lined up a few people to help out. But she said, but it's going to be more than one truckload. And I said, oh my goodness, there was two truckloads. And they filled our fellowship hall with a multitude of goods from your homes. And we got it organized. And I had some snacks for the staff and for the people that came. As people were coming, they could not believe, guys, that the things were free. Well, can I just donate some money? Well, if that's what you want to do. But they could not believe that these goods were free. And on top of that, as they started to exit, Emmanuel was gracious, and I gave them $25 gift certificates to either Food City or Kroger grocery store, and they were really ecstatic. It brought such a genuineness to Matthew 25 incentive that the presbytery is working on. I would have never believed in a million years that we were ahead of their incentive. We're doing it, guys, we're doing it. So, I hope as we approach and go through this urgent COVID time that we'll be prepared to do round two next year. One person on the first day, I think Barbara and I remember this, we still had quite a bit of furniture left on the first day, and it was late afternoon, close to when we were going to close down. And a young lady came in with several children, and she heard this from a friend that, you know, there was something there at that church she might need. And she said, she just looked around, and I asked, I said, well, do you see anything you need? And she said, I just moved into a home, and I have no furniture. I said, taking your pick. And she said, what do you mean? I said, start picking it out. She said, well, how much is it going to cost? Nothing. She said, you mean to tell me that I can get this chair, this bed, this dresser, this table? And I said, ma'am, it's been here all day. And I guess the Lord knew you needed it. Nobody else wanted it. So take God's blessing. And I asked her, I said, when can you pick it up? She said, I'll be back. I'll be back today. She did come back that day. So just the warmness, the genuineness, the conversations that we had between the workers. There was a moment where it slowed down, and we were all sitting in chairs there in that fellowship hall, and we were talking about just everyday stuff, things that we all do. Talked about children, grandchildren, talked about school. You know, we all want the same stuff, right? We all require the same things. We want to be heard, but God puts it all together. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Emmanuel thanks you. And what a wonderful God blessing of us participating in Matthew 25. Thank you.
Thank you, Doris. Now we're called to worship using the words printed in your bulletin. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to God with songs of praise.
As I was selecting a prayer of confession this week, my mind was occupied with Afghanistan and hurricanes coming and flooding in East Tennessee and just all kinds of things that we are struggling with now, and nothing seemed to speak to me. And then I found this by St. Augustine from the 4th century. And it's not a typical prayer of confession, but the words seemed to jump out at me. So I invite you to say them with me today. God of our life, there are days when the burdens we carry chafe our shoulders and weigh us down. When the road seems dreary and endless, the skies gray and threatening. When our lives have no music in them, and our hearts are lonely, and our souls have lost courage. Flood the path with light, we beseech thee. Turn our eyes to where the skies are full of promise. Tune our hearts to brave music. Give us a sense of community with heroes and saints of every age, and so revive our spirits that we may be able to encourage the souls of all who journey with us on the road of life. To thy glory and honor. Amen.
Thank you.
This is good news. We may grow weary, we may be worried, but the Holy Spirit breathes into the very depths of our being, restoring us to lives that reflect the profound goodness of God. Friends, believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Our scripture reading this morning is from Mark's Gospel, chapter 7, various verses. Listen for the word of the Lord. Now, when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they thoroughly wash their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they do not eat anything from the market unless they wash it. And there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups, pots, and bronze kettles. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not live according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that by going in can defile, but the things that come out are what defile. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come: fornication, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, licentiousness, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now we have Miss Allie for a time with our children on the steps.
Oh my goodness. I was worried nobody was going to be here. I was wrong. Good morning. Today I want to talk to you about the word nervous. When you think about the word nervous, is that a feeling you enjoy or a feeling you don't really enjoy? There are no bad feelings, but some we like better than others, right? I don't really enjoy being nervous either. When is a time that you have felt nervous, you know, kind of uneasy or afraid or scared, uncomfortable? Mackenzie, when have you felt nervous?
Nervous when I moved in with Jacqueline and Kat.
Moving to a new place. You can feel nervous. It's something new. It's something different. You're not sure how it's going to be. What about you?
I'm nervous when I go on roller coasters.
Ooh, that's a good one. I don't even do that. I'm so nervous. You're braver than I am. Going on a scary ride where you don't know what it's going to be like?
My dad is in jail and I'm nervous to meet him again.
Yeah, nervous to meet somebody you haven't seen. That's a really good reason to be nervous, Bentley. So nervous, we've all felt nervous before. You know what time I feel nervous? when I come up here to do this. I get really nervous. I don't really like to talk into a microphone. It makes me nervous. But it's something I'm not really ready for, but once I do it, it's usually okay. So one time, you know Lila, my little girl? One time that Lila felt nervous was on Wednesday for her first day of school. Raise your hand if you just recently had a first day of school. Yeah, did you feel a little bit nervous? She was feeling nervous to go back to school, and she said, I want Mama to come with me. And I said, I wish I could go with you, but I have to go to work, and we're going to be apart for a little bit. I said, but Mama is always in your heart with you. Even when we're not together, I'm with you in your heart. And she said something really smart. She said, like God is in our heart. And I thought, she's listening. She hears me. But I also thought, there's our children's sermon for the week. God is always in your heart. Just like when your family member isn't with you, they're still in your heart with you. God is always in your heart, no matter where you go. So when you're feeling nervous, you can put your hand on your heart. Can everybody show me where your heart is? Bentley, where's your heart? Right in the middle. Right in the middle of your chest. That's where God is, and that's where God's love is. No matter where you go, or how you're feeling, or what you're nervous about, God is with you, okay? In the Bible, God says, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. So God says, don't worry. I'm right here in your heart. All right, let's say a prayer together. Dear God, thank you for making our hearts big enough where you can live inside and everyone we love can live inside. Help your children to know that you are always with them. Amen.
Second scripture lesson this morning comes from the little letter to James, which is an interesting little book. Dr. Mont said last week, he said, oh, I see you're starting James next week following the lectionary, because James has not always been popular in church history. every time I read the book of James, I'm reminded of a friend of mine, somewhat tongue-in-cheek, several years ago, said, you know, Buran, I wouldn't jump to conclusions so easily if I weren't right almost all the time. James reminds me of that. He has a kind of moral certainty that could rub us the wrong way, and sometimes he just happens to be right. But I'm reading in the first chapter, every generous act of giving with every gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purpose, he gave us birth by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. For your anger does not produce God's righteousness. Rid yourself of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the word that has the power to save your souls. Be doers of the word, not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror, for they look at themselves and on going away immediately forget what they look like. But those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for widows and orphans in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Again, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. It is an important question. In some ways a simple question, in some ways a very complicated question fraught with a sad history, but nonetheless a question with which people of faith must continually wrestle with. What is important to God? What is important to God? And how do we know that? Who tells us what is important and not important? The knee-jerk answer, I guess, is to say the Bible. Well, which part? At one time, apparently, it was important to God that we not eat shellfish. It was important to God at one time that we slay the Edomites, or that if our eye caused us to sin, then we should pluck it out. In the 1500s, a man named Michael Servetus was put to death. He was a brilliant man, really, a Spanish theologian, kind of a Renaissance man. He was an astronomer, he was a physician, classic underachiever, wrote essays on just about every science field you could think of, wrote essays on the Trinity, which at the time were considered a bit heretical. He said the word Trinity is not in the Bible, which it's not. And he felt that most of the language used to describe God owed more to Greek philosophy than to the Scriptures, which it does. But he was accused of heresy and had to flee his native land, and he ended up in Geneva, where our own founder, John Calvin, welcomed refugees. But even there, he was considered a bit heretical, was put on trial for heresy. Our own John Calvin spoke at the trial in favor of execution. To his credit, he did argue that it should be beheading, that that would be more merciful and Christ-like than the alternative, but to no avail. So in 1553, Michael Servetus was burned alive, because apparently it was important to God, the kind of Greek phrases we use to describe him. We probably have all less dramatic examples of things that we've been taught that is important or not important to God. Conversation I had just a few years ago outside of this context, someone tried to argue with me vehemently that unless you were baptized, fully immersed, completely dunked, your soul was in immortal danger. And I'm like, really? You think that's important to God, the way the water gets on me? At one time, it was considered important to God that persons of color not be allowed to vote, or women, or that gay and lesbian persons should not be in positions of leadership in the church. What is important to God? And if you look at Jesus' life, his ministry, his teachings, particularly these clashes he has with the Pharisees, which, by the way, I think he was a Pharisee and a rabbi. These are some interreligious struggles going on. But it's usually about what's important and not important. Class is a classic example, the Gospel of John. Some people step over a guy who's been laying there sick for years. They step over him in order to go to worship, because that's important to God, right? But what does worship do if not open us up to God's grace, which we show to others? Like the person we just stepped over to get into the temple. Or the passage that Mary read, Mark's has Jesus quoting the prophet Isaiah, who said, "The people worship me, they come and they sing praises. And yet there are children hungry. The needy roam the streets." What is important to God? You've heard me say many times, I think the Pharisees get a bad rap in Scripture. They were the interpreters of God's law. Somebody had to do it, because God's law was to protect the people. If you're a parent and you got young children, you're a Pharisee, right? Because somebody's got to censor things. Somebody's got to monitor what they listen to and hear and watch and say, "Look, honey, it's the law, because we care," right? That should have been like the motto for the Pharisees, you know, "It's the law, because we care." Maybe have a t-shirt printed up with, you know, "Have you hugged a Pharisee today?" "It's the law, because we love you." But Jesus' clash with the Pharisees, particularly here, it's usually involving rituals and traditions, with Jesus pushing them to ask that underlying question, but why are we doing this? What's important to God here? And I know the issue today seems trivial, perhaps, on the surface at least. Jesus' disciples are not washing their hands before they eat. Again, I'm with the Pharisees here. Look, we're at a time of masks and hand sanitizers. I got to go with the Pharisees. But it really wasn't about germs and hygiene as we think of that. This had become one of the things that the Pharisees used to separate themselves from others. Yes, but we're called to be a holy people, a people set apart. So we don't put anything unclean in our bodies. We don't touch anything unclean, like those people, because that would defile us. What we eat makes us pure. And they, by implication, are not pure. So Jesus said, it's not what goes inside us that defiles us. It's what comes out of the human heart, greed and dissension and hatred. That's what makes us unclean. You're treating others as if they are unworthy, as if they are dirty, somehow less than. Ironically, by not washing his hands, and by the way, kids, wash your hands, stay in school, don't do drugs, but in this issue, by not washing his hands, Jesus is saying we're all equal before God. We are all God's children. And what seems to be a very trivial issue in some ways is really a very powerful statement about Jesus embracing all people. And Mark, this gospel that Mary read is written from the perspective of a community that is being treated that way. So in one sense, it's to them saying, don't let anybody tell you you are less than, that you are somehow unworthy, unclean. We're all God's children. But to us today, in a sense, it is also that reminder that what's important to God is how we treat people. And I think that's, for James, it's not only how we treat people, it's how we speak to people, how we speak about people, how we speak in general. I've said this little book, a lot of people think it is very challenging. If you read the whole thing in one sitting, it sounds very moralistic and very judgmental. You go, where's the grace? Where's the grace, James? The grace that Doris talked about. It's free. God loves us. Hey, we're all doing the best we can. And you hear James in the background going, yeah, but that's not good enough. Okay. A lot of times he addresses anger. Again, if you read the whole book, he's got this thing about anger. And he's a little too aggressive about it. Don't get angry. God doesn't like it when you're angry. Stop being angry. Mixed message. The Protestant reformers didn't care for the book. All the effort they put into saying God saves us by God's free grace. We can't work, earn our way into heaven. And here's James saying, well, but you can work your way out of it. Because God calls us to a way of life that does involve our actions. But I don't think that was James's argument. James's argument, I believe, was his dispassionate disconnect that he saw between what Christians, what people of faith were called to do, and what was happening in the world. And he's addressing that disconnect of what is important to God and sometimes what we think is important to God. And prophets and people of faith have called our attention to those disconnects through the centuries. It's the same disconnect John Wesley saw, founder of Methodism in England. When he saw Christian factory owners using children for child labor. It's the same disconnect Martin Luther King Jr. saw. In a land where all people are created equal, but not treated equal. It's the same connect many of us, disconnect we see today when we look at what's important to God, this world, our environment, and what we sometimes do. And yet in the midst of that, James's advice is not that earth-shattering, I suppose. Just be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. But we often reverse that. We're quick to speak, we're quick to anger, very slow to listen. Anger has become our default right now. And some of it, you know, there's unrighteous anger, there's just kind of an unhealthy anger, and then there's a righteous anger against injustice and the things that are happening. But it does seem to be today at the, what's the German word, Zeitgeist, the spirit of the times. The spirit of the times, just right now, it's somewhere between fear and anger and frustration that we're all feeling. And so James has a little practical advice for us. Well, let's just slow down and listen. Maybe to each other, maybe to God. And then he says, be doers of the word. Doers. Not just hearers. Be doers. Because true religion, he says, true religion is taking care of widows and orphans, which is a biblical coverall phrase for those that are most vulnerable in society, those that society considers exposed or disposable, those on the margins. He says that's what religion is about, and to keep oneself unstained from the world, which, as we saw from Jesus, is growing in our capacity to love. Growing in our capacity to love. There was a time in my life when I was really pretty much given up on God and religion and the church, and was disgusted with Christianity. And I know what you're thinking, Buran, was that Tuesday or was that Wednesday? Well, that's a this was another time before that. It was actually in college when really floundering. And, you know, sometimes we have to rebuild our faith. A lot of times we try to just remodel our faith, you know, maybe knock out a wall, put a window over here. I had to, like, take a bulldozer and just knock it down, put down concrete, and rebuild it from the bottom floor. Because that's what we have to do sometimes. Excuse me. But in the midst of that, Madeline Lingle, poet, author, came to Berea College. If you know any of her works, I think A Wrinkle in Time is her most famous work. And she came and she did a lecture. And then after the lecture, she did a little question and answer series for a few of us students who were gathered together. And it was a wonderful discussion. So at one point, she was talking about prayer. And I forget what she was saying about it, but so I raised my hand for a question, and I said, so what do you do when you can't pray? When the words are just not there? And it just sounds like it's just going out into emptiness because you don't know what you believe, what you think. And she said, I know what you mean. Like the problems of the world are just so overwhelming that it just leaves you unable to speak. I'm like, yes. She's like, when it just feels like you have no direction. I'm like, yes. When it feels like faith just isn't working and you don't even know what it is, I'm like, yeah, what do you do then? She said, I pray about it. At the time, I thought that was a little snarky. But over the years, I have come to see the wisdom in that, in continuing to remind myself that A, it's not about me. I'm part of something bigger. And that bigger holds on to me when I feel I can't hold on. See, sometimes we go through the motions in life, in faith, and we forget why we're doing what we're doing. Sort of like the Pharisees were doing. They had forgotten what was important about what they were doing. And we find ourselves going through the motions. At other times, we go through the motions. And just going through the motions of worship, of prayer, of service, it holds on to us and keeps us. And both of these passages remind us that, again, what's important to God at the end of the day is people. You and I, all people, and our shared common humanity, which we can never, ever lose sight of. And I know we know that. I know we hear that. James challenges us to do that. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's join our voices together and say together what we believe using the words of the affirmation of faith printed in your bulletin. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Now, please be seated for prayer. We come before you in humble gratitude, God, remembering all the ways you reveal yourself to us. We see you in the oranges and reds of sunrise and sunset, in masses of colorful flowers with butterflies fluttering around them, and in vibrant rainbows and beautiful blue skies. We feel you in the cooling breeze and rain and in the warmth of sunshine. We hear you in water lapping gently on the lakeshore, in cheerful birdsong, and in claps of thunder during storms. We especially encounter you and your people. We are touched by your love through cherished family and dear friends. We feel your joy in happy laughter and in inspiring music, and we hear your words of wisdom and grace as we listen to the faithful witness for peace, justice, and kindness in our broken and fearful world. We give you thanks and praise for all these things and so much more. But it's been a heavy week, and we're exhausted, God. This pandemic seems like it's going to go on forever. Just as we started to feel like things were getting back to normal, we've had to retreat back into our cocoons, and we know more and more people who have been affected by the virus. The news from around the world is overwhelming. The people of Haiti are suffering because of natural disasters that seem unnatural. The people of Afghanistan are suffering because of the return of an oppressive government. And our service people are in danger as they carry out a humanitarian mission to help them. In our own country, fires continue to consume homes and forests in the West. Flooding in Middle Tennessee and Western North Carolina has taken lives and destroyed homes. Yet another hurricane is bearing down on the Gulf Coast. We want to help in all these situations, but we don't know what to do. Help us to see you more clearly. Let us feel your presence, God, in these difficult and frightening situations. Dry the tears of those who mourn. Sit beside those who are sick or dying. Calm those who are anxious. Give rest to the weary. Give sanctuary to those who flee violence. Give shelter to those who are affected by storms, fires, or other catastrophes. Comfort those who suffer. Reassure those who struggle financially. Provide for the hungry and the homeless. Fill us all with the Holy Spirit that we may be messengers of hope, doing your will in a troubled world. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, as the ushers come forward to receive our gifts and offerings, I encourage you to sign the friendship registers that are at the end of the pew.
In the midst of so much adversity, we find ourselves grateful for the gift of life, for the gift of fellowship and friends and family, for the gift of this community of faith. We pray that you would continue to lead us and guide us and bless us, and that what we give from our hearts would be acceptable, would bring glory to you, and would meet the needs of your people. In Christ's name, amen. disciples of Jesus Christ is the people God has called us to be in the world, and trust that God's spirit and power and presence and graceful love will go with you and keep you. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace from this day forward and forevermore. Amen.